My name is Phil. From the United States. In January of last year, I finished 33 and a half years of sitting in this role in different companies. So what I'm going to share now is both some theory that we think is really important to the background of what's behind the art of hosting, and also some of this from lived experience in organizations for a long time. This is choice. This is the way it is. This is what we choose. And there's other things we can choose. This we can't choose. It's true in our organizations that we work in. It's true in our families that we live in. It's true in this community that's here. There is a underlying pattern of connectedness. If we could imagine this web being all over the floor and elsewhere, what makes it only this size for this purpose is, let's just imagine that this is a bounded organization. And within that organization, this web is operating all the time, whether the CEO likes it or not. This is operative. And what's interesting in this, in the natural system, is purpose for the organization is actually held throughout the organization, whether the CEO or the leadership believes it or not. It may be understood differently depending upon how much involvement the organization has, each person has in defining the purpose, but it's held. But then there's this other phenomena, which is personal purpose, that exists in each person within the web. The degree to which personal purpose can align or is aligned with organizational purpose, typically the more meaning the person gets out of it, and when that is collective, the more the organization benefits from the alignment of personal purpose and organizational purpose. It is often the case, though, that there are maybe positions and people within an organization whose personal purpose is not particularly aligned with the organization. But to the degree that the organization honors in one way or another the personal purpose, even of those people that there's not alignment, alignment starts to happen. I had a person that worked for us who, when we were talking about this in our organization, said, you know, honestly, you want to know the truth? My purpose is in my church. It's not really in here. And I remember asking her, how does your personal purpose in church, how does it get played out? How does it manifest itself? And she said, oh, I sing. I said, Kathy, didn't know. And she said, oh yeah, I've been singing for a long time. I've made recordings. Kathy, would you sometime at one of our holiday gatherings, would you be willing to? She said, yes. So all of a sudden, her personal purpose, which had been parked at church, became honored in the organization, and alignment started to happen. This is the way it is. Then we construct things. This really came out of the Industrial Age. It really came out of a Darwinian view. But it's still as human beings that constructed it. So we're still, even though it feels like a mechanistic system, it came from us. It's not disconnected from us. And sometimes we get into the they,
they is us.
The struggle with this one is, is that oftentimes the people believe the purpose of the organization really can only be held there. And so decisions get made, strategic plans get made, budgets get passed, in which the power for that happens here because that's where the belief that the mission gets held and purpose gets held. And there's a belief that our job is basically to define the parameters for the work for other people to carry out. And for some reason, there's a belief that the larger organizational purpose isn't held throughout the organization. And to the degree that that's the case, it actually does diminish the amount of organizational purpose that can be held in the rest of the organization. What also gets wiped out here, if you don't behave differently, is you can squelch people's sense of personal purpose out of an organization, squeeze it out of an organization, and then you have people who aren't, people then say, why aren't we all pulling in the same direction? It's because there's this construct that is operating under another theory, which is a kind of a Darwinian theory of survival of the fittest, of there are more intelligent and less intelligent. That is the way most of our organizations are organized. Three and a half years I spent in this role, 16 and a half operating from understanding this, 17 operating from here. The transition was huge and painful. We never changed this structure particularly. I knew if I tried to actually organize the thing this kind of way, and have an organizational table that was organized this kind of way, it would take me 5 years to get the board to come and understand it. And I'd be all about theory of organizational structure. And we decided we're not going to do that. What we decided, why this is relevant to me in the art of hosting conversation, is we decided that what we were going to do was we were just going to practice differently. We were going to start to behave differently. And how we started to behave differently was people started to learn circle practice.
Excuse me, what did you say?
I'm sorry.
Can you repeat what you just said?
Yes. What we decided to change was how we practiced. And Art of Hosting was an excellent way of skillful means to change how we practice. When we meet, how we meet are practices. So if this is the executive team and the executive team meets a certain way, they're practicing a certain way of being and they're translating it to the rest of the organization. You can decide to practice your relationships differently. One of the things we started to understand, was that it was all about relationships in any way. So what practices can you engage with that actually gives you a chance to practice relationships? How many times have we said, it's all about relationships? And then I ask people, then how do you practice them? We don't. What are you talking about? How do you practice? Where it's just relationships. It doesn't work like that. I tell the story of our leadership team in the last 16 and a half years of my life, met in circle. Seven of us met in circle every Thursday morning for 16 and a half years. For about an hour and a half. Guess what happens when we do that? You fall in love with the people you work with. And when things change, you get brokenhearted. When people leave, when something happens to someone. My own theory is that part of the reason we don't like to work in the circle for 16 years, because intuitively we know the other side of being in love is also being brokenhearted. This, when we start to practice, so we would meet in World Cafe, our budgets were done in World Cafe, a lot of our decisions about organizational culture, what needed to change, how we needed, things we needed to buy, how we needed to operate the front desk, was often created out of open space. Something you're going to learn here. You already have experienced the World Cafe. I even got the boards to start to work in World Cafe. They started to become more productive, and they started to have relationships with each other when we moved away from this. This has a purpose. It helps. Police, fire, military. But even they have understood, and I can't bring myself to talk about President Trump while you're still Obama. President Obama, that private first class in the field in the military, by his or her behavior, could cause an international crisis. So even in the military, in the United States, they started to understand this, and there's actually practices they put in place. Because they know they have to have this to get certain things done, but they know this is operating. This is always true. Whatever the structure is, that's always operating. And what's interesting about living systems are they have, there are certain things about them that seem to be true. Living systems tend to pay attention to only that which is meaningful to it. How many times have you been in an organization here where the rules have gotten handed down, and then a week later you go, I know I was clear about that, but that's not what's happening. Because we pay attention to what's meaningful to us. In this context, when we're sitting in circle, or we're in a World Cafe, we actually get to talk about what's meaningful to us. And we can also start to come to some consensus about what's meaningful to us. And then we start behaving together in a more consensual way. Because that's the way it is. Living systems cannot be steered or controlled. I lived with the illusion for 17 years. I'm grateful the last 16 and a half I understood something different. And so what I could do was to provide a container for the kinds of conversations that needed to happen. I knew we had to pass budgets. I knew we had a mission we had to meet. I knew we had to meet audits. I knew we had to meet all of our numbers. Guess what? People that get shared with people, they say, yeah, I want to be part of that. We always made our numbers. We were always successful financially. We were able to do all that stuff and it wasn't controlled. Natural systems seek diversity because it increases the chances of survival. We were very, very, very conscious that the makeup of our staff looked like the community. Because there are some things that we did for the community, with the community, we need to look like it. So we hired that way. Interestingly, in natural systems, the parts are actually concerned about its neighbors because it's not survival of the fittest, it's survival of fit. And so when we understand that If you're successful, I am, because we're in this network. People start to take care of each other. The people I have worked with for 16 and a half years, this is encircled with, I'm not there anymore. Until the day I die, I'll have their back. Because it was relationships, it wasn't about our work. Systems change with a change in perspective of who it is. Interestingly, we never talked much about this. We behaved this way. I wasn't ever sure outside our organization if there was any sense of that. And recently I was meeting with a physician who said, that was really cool structure you had when you were the CEO at CMA. And I said, really, that? And he said, no, that wasn't it. That wasn't your structure. What was your structure? I didn't get into this. But the point of the matter is, outside the organization, they could feel the difference and see the difference. They thought this, they didn't think this was the way we operated. Because our perception of ourselves was not this. No.
Started going on. All the links began to make sense around the why. Why do we do this participatory leadership? How is this important? Just because I like it better doesn't mean it works better. But what's the underlying reason why this feels like an important thing to do? And as we look at this living system model, which sometimes is called a complex adaptive system, this mechanistic system, knowing that they're both happening at the same time. I remember, and this is during MSLS as a student in my thesis research, kind of looking at art of hosting and the complexity of the social and environmental sustainability issues, and there's something here that needs to link. There's something we're doing in the world of sustainability that's relying on experts to tell us what to do and to argue over what's happening and what's not happening. And in the meantime, it's all changing, but we're not. At least not fast enough. So there was something about this idea of complexity that was like a little brain worm that I couldn't get rid of. And it was this particular model that finally cracked that aha in my head. So this is my very favorite model. No bias here. And if you haven't seen this word before, don't try to pronounce it by looking at it. Those are the people who know what it sounds like. Cynefin. If you look at it, it's Cynefin or something like that. The Cynefin model helps us understand what kind of situation are we in right now. And at any moment, that could shift. Are we in a situation that is simple or very obvious, complicated, complex, or utter chaos and destruction? Or do we not even know? We can't even tell what situation we're in. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what are those different kind of situations. Because in each one, a different leadership stance is helpful. Okay? And they relate to these ways of working. So we're going to start with this one. When a situation is simple, you can think in terms of the link between cause and effect being really obvious. Just direct. You know, if I pick up David Hutchins' iPad and I let it go, what's gonna happen?
I'm going to run up there.
Yeah, David's going to fly off the floor. Catch a big boy against the floor. Obvious response.
That's right.
So the link between, find my colored here. The link between cause and effect is a direct line. No questions asked. Once we know what that is, we can repeat it over and over and over. So when we think about things like, well, where does that show up in situations where we work? It's rarely in human relationships. Those are a little less predictable, cause and effect. Some of them are pretty directly predictable. Most are not. But it would show up in the space of, like, think about manufacturing this pen. Once we have figured it out, we repeat that same process over and over and over. And because we know the direct link between cause and effect, we can do it faster and more efficient every time. And so comes the invention of lean manufacturing, where everything gets more and more streamlined and efficient, and we can make 100 million of these, and they're identical. That lies in the simple domain, right? In that particular domain, you know the word best practice? How many of you have to use the word best practice at work? So best practice people here? Yeah. That's only possible if you have an absolutely predictable link between cause and effect. If you're working in a field where that's not true, best practice is not possible. It's a great word, we like the lingo, but it's not possible. And in that domain, you sense what's going on, you categorize it into known buckets, and you respond. And the quicker you can do that, the more efficient you are. When things get a little more complicated, similarly, we know the link between cause and effect. There's just more variables, there's more links. Tape is not working today. I may end up having folders. Let's see. In the complicated domain, we have to actually analyze to figure out what's the link between cause and effect. So you think of any of the sciences, any of the engineering sciences. It takes a while to do the research and the analysis to figure out how do we get from here to here? How do we get the, figure out how to design the airplane and get it off the ground and get it to fly and get it to land the same time every, the same way every time. I really want it to land every time really safely. But it's kind of complicated. It wasn't a simple process to do that. We can repeatedly send people to the International Space Station and then bring them home safely, right? Over and over. Super complicated. But because it's repeatable, it's a predictable pattern. So in this realm of complicated, what we have to do is sense what's going on and analyze it and then respond. And in that realm, thank you, whiteboard.
It's a complicated.
Apparently, the German companies figured out the simple solution to tape.
The pizza is really good.
I'm afraid to write on it now.
So in this field, we can't quite get the best practice because there's still some things that can influence, you know, that airplane flying or what happens between our atmosphere and the space station. But we can get to good practice and we can continue to bring in fresh analysis. So this is really important. We need the expertise of scientists in that space. So again, we talked down here about this being something like lean manufacturing, and this being like airplanes and rocket ships can fit up here, and experts are really key. And one of the things to know in this domain, when you think about how the company to build the airplanes is organized, it probably looks a lot like this, because we really want some clear channels of quality control and communication and that. Even though as they figure all this out, the humans look like this, okay? See the difference? Like we have to have some of the structure, particularly in this domain. One of the pieces of language that the developer Dave Snowden uses with this is fail-safe. We need a fail-safe system. We can't afford to fail when we're in these systems, right? That's catastrophic. So these are fail-safe situations. When we move over into the complex domain, an interesting thing happens, and that is that the link between cause and effect has so many variables in such a long time span that you can only see the cause in hindsight, like in decades long hindsight. And the examples for that would be like climate change. Well, like who knew that was coming? Well, who knew back in the 70s when we started teaching recycling and started teaching about alternative fuels, how carbon was gonna impact the planet? But we know now because we can look back, we can track that data. So the data is still necessary. But it's a little bit, my friend Zion says, it's a little bit like putting a GPS tracker on a pigeon. You can get tons of data of where he's been, but you don't know where he's going next. Right? It's not a predictable next step. So it's not a simple, there's no such thing as best practice. You can't replicate. So things like climate change, any of the social issues we're dealing with, it's happening so fast and moving so quickly. 20, 30, 40 years from now, we'll be able to look back and go, oh, that's what led to this and led to this, and we'll be able to see the pattern, but we're in it right now, we can't really see ahead. So it takes a different kind of thing, approach to that. My favorite example is try raising the same teenager twice, right? There are too many variables over time for that to be a predictable thing. It's just not gonna stick. Tables are wet. I think I was talking to somebody while I made this poster.
Me.
I was talking to someone while I was making this poster, so it's probably. In chaos, we're talking about you have no idea what's happening. It's a complete crisis, right? So it's a natural disaster, it's a flood, it's a war, it's something totally unpredicted, unexpected is happening. And again, that's not something that best practice applies to. You have to act immediately to kind of bring, you know, make sure the blood is still flowing, and then sense what's needed, and then respond. But act comes first. So in each of these, there's a pattern of how we respond. On this side, we need multiple perspectives to find the new solutions. Whereas on that side, it's knowable, so one person can kind of guide and direct and lead. On this side, what we need is prototypes that where you are, it's safe to fail, because we just have to experiment. We just have to send out a lot of experiments and see which one works, and then follow the one that's working. So we're trying to create situations where it's safe to fail here, so we're failing forward, we're learning as we go. Right, so it's a different stance. When we talk about, I'm not gonna bother with tape, when we talk about this word emergence that was in the middle of this breath pattern, that's true in this complex domain. We're looking for emergent practice, something we didn't know going in that's grown out of the multiple perspectives helping find a new solution. This is emergent practice space.
This is a novel practice space, and we've already had best and good practice. So the interesting for me about this is that the leadership stance with this one requires a little more on this side of a spectrum that goes from total destructive chaos towards just chaos, that means towards a little more order and towards control. So the spectrum of what the situation is. But between order and control rises the kind of leadership that is often present here that we all know is management. Right? So you're managing multiple details. And we need managers. I need a manager. To keep all those details in order, to keep things moving forward, especially if you think about this convergent end of the breath, right? You're moving into action, you've got times and roles and deadlines and performance indicators and all that. You need management. But it is a place where we're working with order and control. When we're working in these systems, this complexity and chaos, we don't know what's going on. It's in between these two realms, and it rises up here. And I'm going to use the word leadership here. I realize that has different connotations and meanings in different cultures. What we're talking about is the kind of leadership here we call participatory. I can almost not reach that. So as we're trying to bring in many perspectives, it's not about asking an expert to figure it out and tell us what to do. It's about inviting expertise from all different aspects of the system. Kaisa said, if you're working with young people and solving an issue with the school, then invite the young people to the conversation. Their perspective matters. They know what's going on. They have insights we will never have. You need the manager. You need the person who sweeps the floor. You need the nurse. You need the mother of the sick child. Like, all of those perspectives help us to see the whole system and find the emergent solution that actually then becomes something more manageable, where you can move into action. But in the finding of it, you need the kind of leadership that can dance this line between chaos and order. And we call this the chaotic path, or chaos and order. And so a lot of the work that we're gathered around is to practice, because there's plenty of management schools to teach you that type of leadership. If that's what you need, go to that school. This way of working with leadership is about participatory leadership. How do we engage other people and be in the not knowing together? And bring all our perspectives and all of our innate brilliance to that. And sit with the stew until something new comes out that none of us brought into the room to begin with. And that's the emergent knowledge that then helps us find new solutions. Otherwise, we just repeat the same solutions in different clothes, because we're working from past experience. So these all link together from how we're structured, how a living system actually works. And this is simply to inform us which kind of leadership is needed. I don't know how much time we have for questions.
Tracy, yeah. Camos, is that a word?
Shamos, yeah. Thanks. That's like a beyond chaos, like a destructive chaos, like all out war, total destruction.
Okay. I was just waiting for you to explain that word.
Well, it's new to me too. I still sometimes wonder why we put it up there, because it adds a little confusion. Yeah?